Hello. Last week was the midterm exam. The midterm exam results will be announced next week. I will post the grades, midterm exam questions and answers on the course website. And I updated the accuracy of assignment two. This is the final update. If you submit the assignment after the deadline, the accuracy for those assignments will not be updated. For each assignment, I will update accuracy every week until the week following the deadline. So for each assignment, there will be four accuracy updates. During the first three updates, you may find, if you find any issues with your assignment, you can make corrections. However, if there are still problems during the final update, then you won't have the opportunity to make further corrections. Therefore, please take advantage of each opportunity to update your assignment. The earlier you submit your assignment, the better chance you have to make corrections to your program. And I also found some students plagiarized. They send the same assignments. Here is one principle. You can discuss the assignments with classmates, but when you write a program, you cannot see their source code. So if plagiarism is found, then this will affect your semester grades. So you should write your assignments independently. And I also announced assignment three, and the due date is 3 weeks later. Now let's see assignment three. Remember to follow the rules to send assignments. This assignment is related to decoder. The input of this assignment is a sequence of bits, a sequence consisting of zeros and ones. So the input is like the program input is like this one. 1 1 0 0 1 0 1 1 1. And your program will decode this sequence into messages. The messages are related to weather, and the output messages can be divided into four categories: fine, cloudy, rainy, snow. And you should follow this rule to decode the input sequence. And I will use this example to illustrate how to decode the input sequence. And you can see this figure. Now suppose the input sequence is 1 1 0 1 0 1 1 1. And we want to decode this sequence. And we start from the leftmost digit. So we start from 1. And you look this table and you look up this rule. The first digit is 1. So there are 3 possibilities. Cloudy, rainy, or snow. So we need to move to the next digit to determine which message to output. So we move to the next digit. The next digit is 1. And now we have 2 possibilities. 1-1 could be rainy or 1-1 could be snow. So we need to move to the next digit. And this digit is 0. And now we know 1-1-0 should output rainy. So here, when we see 0, we know we should output rainy. Then we move to the next digit. The next digit is 5. The next digit is 0. And for 0, there is only 1 possibility. Fine. So when you see 0, you output fine. And then we move to the remaining digits. The next digit is 1. And again, if the digit is 1, then there are 3 possibilities, and we need to move to the next digit. The next digit is 0. And according to this rule, 1-0 is cloudy, so we output cloudy. And you can follow this procedure to make this to output messages. So the last message is snow. So the program output for this input is for this input sequence, your program should output rainy space fine space cloudy space snow. So this is the decoding process. And I also provide a code template. You can modify this template to complete the assignment. Here is the template. Let's take a look. First, I will declare a variable code. So this code is it's like a character array. So this variable will be used to contain this input sequence. So this code you can treat code as an array. And this array will contain the input sequence. So I use cin to read the user input and save the user input in this variable. And you can use code. You can use code break 0 to access the first element. And then I create an index variable. The index variable begins from 0. And the index variable should be less than the length of code. The range of the index is from 0 to length minus 1. And we can use code break it I to access each input character. And if you want to compare, whether the input digit is equal to zero, you can use this expression. You compare. This is the Boolean expression. You compare code at index I is equal to character zero. Here we should use a single quote to enclose this digit because this is a character array, not an integer array. So if you want to compare if you want to know whether this digit is equal to zero, you should write expression like this. This line is wrong because each element is not an integer. Each element is a character, so you should use a single quote to represent a character. So for this example, suppose the input sequence is this one, then the code is like this. So when the input sequence is this one, then the code is like a character array. And for this one, the length is you can use this expression to retrieve the length of the input sequence. And one important thing to note is that you should make sure that the index is between zero and you should ensure that the index is within the legal range. The legal range is between zero and length minus one. And if the index is outside this range, then if the index is not within the valid range, then your program might cause runtime error or produce unknown results. And if this happens, the accuracy of your program is zero. So when you write this, when you write program, you need to ensure your index is within the legal range. And you can use the following code to check the index. and we will illustrate the usage of these statements. And your program output, you can assume all the input sequences are legal. So my test input will only contain legal inputs. And your program output must conform the following requirements. Each message is case sensitive, and each message is separated by one space. So the principle is the same. Your program output should be exactly the same as the one I provided here. So do not output any additional line breaks or output additional spaces, and do not modify the CL statements in the code template. For example, do not modify this line. Some students remove the space. This will lead to if you remove the space, then this will cause the evaluating program not be able to evaluate your assignment. You cannot output additional line breaks. This will also cause the evaluating program to unable to judge your program. And I also provide more input output samples. After you have finished your program, you can use the input output samples to test your program and to see the your program output is the same as the one in this file. This assignment is related to information theory. For example, we want to transmit whether messages from one place to another place. Then we send a sequence of zeros and ones. So we have a transmitter and a receiver. The transmitter transmit a sequence of bits, and the receiver need to decode the received sequence into messages. And we have many options to encode the messages. So for example, you can we can have other strategy to encode the weather message. For example, zero, we can encode fine as 00 and 01 to cloudy. This is another encoding strategy. This strategy uses 2 bits to encode the weather message. But the assignment, this assignment, this depends on the message. So this assignment uses a different strategy to encode the weather message. And in your opinion, which strategy is better? This one, use two bits to encode the weather message, or use the strategy in this assignment. So, do you know which strategy is better? If you think the 2 bits, this is all messages are encoded into 2 bits, but in the assignment, the message may be encoded into 1 bit or 2 bits or 3 bits. So which strategy is better? If you think this strategy is better, please. Raise your hand. If you think the 2 bits strategy is better, please raise your hand. Okay. And this depends. Which strategy is better depends on your application. For example. For example, we are in Kaohsiung, so the weather is usually fine. There is a high probability that the weather is fine. So the probability of fine might be 90%. And the cloudy and rainy are very rare. So in this scenario, this strategy will be better if the probability of fine is very high. So this depends on your application. You can choose different encoding strategies. This week we will learn parameters and overloading, and we can take a look at the slides. This chapter has 3 parts. The first part is about function parameters. And there are 2 ways to pass parameters. The first way is call by value. The second way is call by reference. Or you can mix the two. You can mix call by value and call by reference. The second part is about function overloading. We can define a function. Use the same function name but with different input parameters, and this is called function overloading. The third part is about how to test and debug your program. And I will introduce some methods to test your program. Let's see one example first. Here I define one function phi. This function has two inputs. The first input is hours worked. The second input is minutes worked. And the second input is modified by the first assignment. And in the main function, we make a function call to phi. And two inputs are hours and minutes. Hours is 12 and minutes is 30. And we know that we modify the second input in the first line of the function definition. So after this function call, what is the value of minutes? So after this function call, what is the value of minutes? The value is 30 or this one. This one is 12 times 60 plus 30. So after this function call, what is the value of minutes? Its value is 30 or the second one. If you think the value is 30, please raise your hand. If you think after this function call, the value of minutes is 30. Okay, and if you think the value is the second one, please raise your hand. Okay, and let's see the result. The result is after this function call, the value of minutes is still 30. So this means this function call will not modify the value of minutes. Because we define this function because the way we invoke this function is called call by value. Call by value means we copy the value of this one. We copy the value of minutes. We copy 30 into this local variable. Minutes worked is a local variable defined defined within this function block. So this is a local variable declared within this block. And then call by value means we copied the value 30 to this variable, to this local variable. And when you modify this local variable, this will not affect your second input. Because you only modify the local variable defined within this block. So this is called call by value. You copy the value of your input, you copy the values of the input parameters to the local variable. So if you modify the local variable, this will not affect the input parameters. So after this function call, the input parameters remains the same. And the next, I will introduce the second way to pass the parameters. The second way is called call by reference. And to use call by reference, this is very simple. You just add one operator, ampersand. This is the ampersand. You just add the ampersand after the data type. You can add a space or remove the space. So if you add the ampersand operator after the data type, then this function will becomes call by reference. Call by reference means you pass the memory address of this variable to this function. So this operator means call by reference. So when you use call by reference, then the memory address of this variable will be sent to this function. And if you use call by reference, then the output will be different. Let's compile again. We see that after this function call, the second input is modified. Its value becomes 750, which is 12 times 60 plus 30. So if you use call by reference, then any modification to input parameters will affect input. So if you use call by reference and if you modify your input parameters, and then this will affect your input parameters after the function call. And let's take a look of the slides. So we have two methods to pass parameters. We can use call by value or call by reference. Call by value means you copy the value of the parameters to local variables defined in the function. And call by reference means you pass the address of the input arguments. So when we use call by value, then we copy value to the local variable defined inside the function. So when we use call by value, then minutes worked is a local variable in this function definition. So if we modify, we only modify the copy, we only modify the local variables. And the call by value is the default method. So when you define a function, and if you do not use end, if you do not use end, then this function is call by value. And if you want to use call by reference, then you need to specify, you need to add the ampersand operator after the data type. And the chorus data can be modified by the code function if you use the call by reference mechanism. And next, I will show more examples about when to use call by reference. Now suppose we have two integer variables, X and Y. Now suppose we want to exchange the values of the two variables. To do this, we need to use a temp variable to store the value of either X or Y. So if we want to exchange the values of X and Y, then we can perform statements like this. So after the statements, we see that X becomes 3 and Y becomes 2. So the three statements swap the values of X and Y. And now suppose we want to write a function to perform these statements. So now suppose we want to write a function. We want to make a write a function to swap values of X and Y. Then we implement this function like this. The return data type is void because we didn't return any value. So the return data type is void. And we have two inputs. And this function performs, this function aims to swap the values of the two inputs. But after this function call, you see that X, Y remains the same. Their value do not exchanged. This is because now this function is called by value. And the call by value only modify the local variable. So if we want to exchange the values of x and y, then we should use call by reference. And to do this, we need to modify the input parameters. We need to add the ampersand operator after the data type. And if you do this, then this function becomes call by reference. So we see that after this function call, the values of x and y are exchanged. This is because this is a call by this function is call by reference. So if you want to use call by reference, then you add the ampersand operator after the data type. Next, I will show another example. So now suppose we want to read user input and save the input into X. So for example, I enter some value 5. Then the value of X becomes 5. And suppose now we want to write a function to perform the two statements. So now suppose we want to suppose we want to write a function to read the user input and save the value in X. And if we run this program and I type some input, we see that after this function, the value of x is not changed. Its value is still 2, not 5. And this is because this function is called by value. So if we want to use call by reference, then we need to add the ampersand operator after the data type. And then we recompile again. If I enter 5, then after this function call, the value of x becomes 5. Because here I use call by reference. So when you want to use call by reference, then you add the ampersand after the data type. Then this will modify this will modify your input parameters. When So to use call by value or call by reference, this depends on your applications. Sometimes you only need call by value. For example, you want to display some results from the inputs. In this case, you only need to use call by value because you don't need to modify the input parameters. So in this case, you only need to use call by value. But when you want to need to modify your input parameters, then you should use call by reference. And we can also mix the use of call by reference and call by value. So for example, you can define a function. The first parameter is passed by value, while the remaining two parameters are passed by reference, because the second one and the third one has the ampersand operator. Time is up, so we can take a break for 10 minutes.